Good morning, afternoon, and evening. Welcome back to the Liberal Artist Podcast. As always, I'm your host, Bodhi Papula, and with me, I have Kaylee Horowitz.
Dive!
And Andy Gibby Gibson has been, Andy Gibby's been locked back in the editing mines. We locked the
Not
door.
Not even
this
the dungeon.
Time.
That's the mines.
It's the mines. He got an expansion, right? We gave him a little bit more space.
The children yearn for the mines.
The child yearns for
the child.
No,
Gibby the child Gibson.
it's still summer vacation. We gave
for now Gibby, just barely.
It's the end where, you know, fall's rolling around. So we gave Gibby the episode off and decided the two other goofballs will play games.
That's what we are, the goofballs.
The goofs. Kaylee, you have done school much more recently than I have.
I suppose, in a manner of speaking, yeah.
Yeah, no, you got your is it a year ago you got your master's now?
Yeah. Oh.
Yeah, that's crazy.
I mean, I guess
right?
Technically too, because I finished in December of 22 and was approved by my committee.
Yeah.
And was like, not commenced, but the other academic-y term that's like, yeah, you got it, you did it, in February of 23. Had to then wait until May to actually, like, get my diploma and walk. So it felt like a very weird, like, oh, right, I made a thesis, got a master's degree. I'm back here again.
Yeah. Did they make you do anything at that time, or were you just kind of
no
chilling?
I was just straight up done. Like, it's a I finished my degree in three semesters.
Yeah.
And because my university does not have a graduation every semester, like, they don't, at the very least, they don't do like a winter and a spring.
Oh.
It was just, yeah, anytime people are done, y'all gotta wait for May to come around if you want to do the pomp and circumstance and walk.
Yeah.
I finished everything and was like, yep, you are officially done in February of 23. Because until then, I still have the excuse of still technically being a university student all of January while I was finishing my job that was paying for me to afford nice little treats in life and not be poor and sad.
So we got another
month out of it.
Where I was going was, what is your favorite summertime activity as an adult, right? Like, during college?
Disassociating and watching cartoons.
Okay. No.
As an adult, you say, that's the clarifier.
That's the clarifier, as an adult.
You know, I do enjoy the freedom of, like, adult summer vacation. Being able to be like, yeah, I don't have to be up at like 7 o'clock. Like, I like college mode. Like, you are an adult enough with some amount of sense to make your own decisions, smart or otherwise. But it's that, like, yeah, I am on vacation. I don't have to be up at a certain time. I can just, like, stay home. But it is the managing of being like, but I should go out. I should go at least see friends, even if we're not going to do a lot. I should get myself out of the house. That I think adult summer vacation, like, favorite pastimes are just the, like, let's just pick a silly little thing to go do. Even if it's not fun, or it's not like, oh, this is such a life-changing experience. Like, I don't, would it be nice to spend thousands of dollars to go to, like, the Mexican coast for a long weekend with friends? Sure, but, like, bitch, give me some, like, Smirnoff ice and a pool, and that's fine.
Right. The older I get, the more I appreciate, was, like, I just want to
gather. I just miss my friends.
Right, I just want to gather, you know, 2 to 5 people whose time I really enjoy.
Yeah.
Find a big-ass comfy couch.
Yes.
And we just sit in the same room together.
Honestly, yeah, it's what our friend Jacob and I always, like, hound the rest of our Discord group with the fact that we're the kind of neurodivergent that are like, we enjoy parallel play. We like just being in a Discord room
and playing our own video games.
Exactly, because we can't be in the same room together with all of our friends doing that. We aren't all sitting on a couch doing our own little things, but just like vibing and keeping it tight. So the next best thing is summoning everyone to the Discord. Just for me to be on Stardew Valley, Jacob and Bo to maybe be playing like either Elden Ring together or all being on a drop of
Helldivers.
Helldivers. Yeah. I was about to say Warhammer for some reason.
We're not kind of nerd, unfortunately.
No. But yeah, just like stuff like that. I mean, I do also enjoy being able to like go out and do stuff. Like I do try to like if there is a theater that's doing like a summer spectacular or like a Shakespeare in the Park, like trying to like mark the passage of time with making myself like go out and experience something that is a like, hey, this only happens at this point in the year, or like this is only going to be happening until X time for however many weekends, or farmers market out here usually kicks up at the top of summer. So it's that like, all right, let's start trying to kind of just get back in the habit of like, yeah, you can bed rot for 2 days in a row, but maybe give that a break and like get up this morning, get dressed, go out for a little bit, get a little treat at one of the food trucks there, maybe buy some groceries, and then you can come back home. But you've at least gone out of the apartment.
It's now occurring to me that I've lived in LA for 2 years and I haven't been to Disney.
Ooh.
Because it's like, it's one of those things, right? I'm an adult and Disney is expensive. So it's like, what the fuck am I going to do over there? And it's like, experience
arguably,
it.
Isn't like California Adventure a little cheaper? Like, I mean, they're not.
So
I
think
it's not like
the,
it's still not expensive. But
yeah, I think they're the same now. Okay. Like they're mashed together, basically.
Fuck are you doing, Bob?
Robert.
Robert.
I've been to Universal, but I haven't actually like been in the park.
Oh, did you just go to City Walk?
Yeah, basically. So the AMC at Universal
that's
does
what
all
we
the
used
special
to do
stuff
in Orlando. That if you don't want to just like go to Universal, you just go do a couple laps around City Walk. There's a Margaritaville. There's a Hard Rock Cafe. There's an AMC theater. There's a Cinnabon. You don't need to go into the theme park at all.
Fuck, am I gonna do at Super Mario World? Gonna go watch
a
movie.
Okay, Super Mario World does look really freaking cool, though. Like, I get where it's that, like, yes, it looks cool, but they're only focusing on, like, the 5-4 things that are actually here, because, like, they had to build it up fast and draw up hype, so there's not, like, an expansive land yet, but it does look cool.
Shigeru Miyamoto already gets enough of my money, and I'm never happy about it. I'm not gonna go ride his rides, but no. City Walk has the AMC, and like you were saying, like these limited
Voodoo
seasonal
Donut
things
Company
they do
in Orlando. City Walk is so good.
I gotta see if there's like one up there.
Oh, I don't remember what translates like as far as the stores they're partnered with between California and Orlando, but oh my god, Voodoo Donuts.
It's definitely in Margaritaville. But the AMC does like these like seasonal or weekly showings. Like I went and watched Lord of the Rings in IMAX the other day, which was cool. But I always forget how long those movies are. It was the extended cut.
Actually, I changed my answer. Favorite summer activity as an adult is just like going on a bender for a weekend, marathoning some amount of like themed selection of movies or content. Pick your substance of choice. We aren't leaving this apartment for 3 days until we finish.
Not
all
until
of this.
It's
Let's
done.
Go.
Have I done that this year? Oh man, I tricked a friend of mine into doing that with Avatar: The Last Airbender.
Oh my god!
Because she had never seen it, and
you just
I was like,
a season a day, it's fine.
Yeah. I was like, no, check this out. She's like, oh, that's fun. And then the other
you
friend
aren't allowed
like,
to leave
her
until it's done.
I know I've done it with Bleach. Ooh. I've done it with Justice League. That was all during COVID time, so it was a combination of summer binging, and also I'm depressed. Here's some nostalgia.
You know, we did Avatar during the pandemic. That was the like, yeah, let's just watch this again. Why not?
Yeah.
Did
you just do Last Airbender, or did you go all the way through Legend of Korra?
We ended up picking up with Korra, I think, after we moved. Like, yeah. I think we just ran out of, we were like, we're finishing Avatar before Ian had to leave. But I think we finally got to Buffalo. We were like, we should finish this. You haven't seen Korra. We should get through the rest of this.
Yeah, yeah. I always get to like season 3 of Korra, and season 2 is such a slog that I'm just like, no more, please.
Please stop. convergence.
But we do have a topic of something I could watch and have watched over and over and over.
Oh, yes.
Again, today, let's get into 2001's Atlantis, The Lost Empire.
Dive, dive, dive!
Again, one of my favorite things about you, Kaylee, is that when I mention or ask about Disney stuff, there's always like the weird, obscure corners. Very early in our friendship, I think this came up, and we had the Spider-Man meme of pointing at each other. Wait, you like this thing? I like this thing. Nobody else likes this thing.
Yes. Yeah, I was like, when did the... Yeah, no, I don't remember the circumstances, but I do remember that just sort of being the, like, general mood versus the rest of the group we were with being like, the fuck are you talking about?
So...
Us being like, this is a masterpiece.
This is peak.
Cinema.
Atlantis, The Lost Empire is, like, one of the weird... B-rank Disney films that came out right after the what would you say the end of the Disney Renaissance was, like, probably Mulan, I
yeah
guess?
Mulan is usually the marked like end of the Renaissance. Some people will extend it to Fantasia 2000, but like, yeah,
who's even seen that?
That's one of those where it's like, it's gorgeous. Yeah. But it's not necessarily everyone's like favorite. I'll put myself in the firing line. I have not met one person who's like, oh yeah, Fantasia 2000 is my favorite Disney movie.
Right.
I adore and appreciate a lot of it. Like, it is a gorgeous piece of animation work. But it's the whole point of it is like, yeah, this is a kind of retribute to the first Fantasia that is much more in line with the, like, you know, at a time when Disney was a company with creative pursuits and artistic interest in pushing boundaries, and interest in reinvigorating the same spirit of like the original Fantasia with different compositions, with different, you know, different prompts, different styles, different animators, just kind of being able to like lead projects and be like, yeah, and we're all just going to package it up in this nice little movie for you. Here you go. Beautiful art piece. But Mulan was 99. This was 2000, and then, yeah, we hit this weird point of, like, we just came off of a banger streak of stuff. What do we do next?
Yeah.
People aren't really interested in, like, the print. Like, people are kind of getting over the princesses. Like, we did a number of those during the Renaissance. We did The Little Mermaid, we did Beauty and the Beast. We did Aladdin, which, like, doesn't
which is
really
like
count, but it's
technically
kind of, it's halfway in, halfway out.
Hercules was really our only step. Hercules and Lion King were our only steps away from the princess motifs in that time. Was there anything else that came out in that time?
Oh, no. You know what it is? It's that's kind of the double-edged sword of the end of it is Tarzan.
Is Tarzan a princess movie?
No, but we get Jane thrown into those a lot of the, like, what are we doing with this character? So it's the kind of double-edged, like, you're ending the 90s, entering the 2000s with one beautiful passion art project, one last princess, but she's a badass movie.
Yeah.
And one, how do we adapt this story and get the kids to think we're cool? What if instead of skateboarding, we're skating on vines?
They were right.
And getting Phil Collins to do all of the soundtrack, which were two great choices, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm.
But But kind of sitting in that weird nexus of knowing, like, okay, people are getting a little sick of the princess stuff. We've already done a couple things pushing, like, towing those lines of, like, some typical story beats of especially guy-girl relationships, love interest kind of stuff. That you're right, Hercules is one of the only ones in that gambit. We don't talk about the rescuers down under.
Did that come out in this time? That's
yes,
hilarious.
It did.
That movie sucks.
Well, cutting right to the chase then. Oh boy. Oh yeah, and Pocahontas. That's the other thing that really started to like.
That's a princess movie, though.
It's
definitely not of the
movie.
Same caliber of the other ones.
No, it's not.
But it's still a princess movie.
Yeah.
She's
okay.
A...
So the classification of the Renaissance, and mostly just because I'm like, I think I remembered all these, but I wanted to make sure. Little Mermaid, Rescuers Down Under.
Yep.
And this is in chronological order. Beauty and the Beast, Aladdin, Lion King. Pocahontas, Hunchback, Hercules, Mulan, Tarzan.
So the ones that aren't specifically princess movies are like Hercules, Lion King, Hunchback, and Atlantis falls right outside of that.
Exactly. And so Atlantis falls into that category of movies, and we'll get into this a little bit more probably, but this has been a movie that's like, this was one of my fixations as a child, and like as an adult didn't get any better, that it was a like, oh, who were the people responsible for this? So I just kind of know that now because but Gary Trousdale and Kirk Wise, who are the directors of this film, it was also produced by Don Hahn and written by Tab Murphy, who these are names that were circulating in and around the Disney Renaissance films the entire time. Gary and Kirk co-directing, I believe, as well, producing Beauty and the Beast. Tab Murphy would being brought into Disney for the first time to do the screenplay for Hunchback and being like a nervous wreck the entire time to be like, I want to do this story justice, but I also don't want to piss Disney off. But I don't want to like water down Victor Hugo because it's a beautiful story.
It's also not friendly.
And so, like, people that got pulled into and kind of moved out through different films in that era leading up to the 2000s, like, prove their worth, kept their heads down, fucking worked their asses off against Jeff Katzenberg and Michael Eisner having their own sort of pissing competition with one another, especially during this time period. But people that like gave it their all, put their backs into it, and then went, hey, we carried a lot of these things. Not all of them were the same metrics of success as others, but like overall, the Renaissance was a banging era for them. That finally we get through all of these. We're noticing this trend of princess fairy tale-y kind of stuff isn't sticking currently. What do we do instead? How do we pivot? Letting these guys kind of ask for some of the things that they had been trying to pitch for years. One of them being that was pitched at the same time, basically, or around the same time that production was happening for Great Mouse Detective. So like right before the Renaissance started, was this idea of a space treasure island, which would finally get to see the light of day as Treasure Planet. In the 2000s. And Atlantis was one of these things being tossed around by these guys of like, I think there was a t-shirt made, basically a t-shirt or a hat or something made for this production crew that was, we're not doing a musical or something like that. Like, we're not doing musicals, basically, was the sentiment of the production team working on Atlantis.
Yeah.
That they were like, we want to push something. We want to do something that's still going to be interesting to the audiences that we currently are making movies for, but that is something entirely different. And we want to play with new technology. Like, these early 2000s movies are playing with computer graphics in weird ways that not always worked. Dinosaur. and other times, I think, still hold up pretty well. Like, a lot of the, like, layering between two-dimensional and three-dimensional elements in Atlantis and Treasure Planet, I think, still hold up pretty darn well.
I 100% agree, because you do get that. Atlantis is outside of the magic, very much based in real world. Because the setting of the film is like the 40s, 50s?
No, 1914.
14, correction. It's the 10s.
We are in the fallout of World War One going, ha!
Which is...
That was kind of shitty. Let's not do that again.
which makes the cast even more interesting, which is... not even like the casting options, because all the actors do phenomenally, but like... Oh, yeah. The faces of the cast members, that makes that even more interesting, which we'll get into. But they do the wonderful thing of, all right, our base reality is standard traditional two-dimensional art with like really, really, really fantastic line work. I know that's like a weird thing to get onto, but you look at the characters and they're very distinct. They have this stylistic blockiness to them.
Well, it's
that I really, really enjoy.
Feature shout out. It was because they brought in Mike Mignola as one of the like main style direction artists.
Yeah.
Who was a comic artist, most well known for Hellboy and a number of other things.
That makes so much more sense.
Yeah. So that's what, again, one of these, like, I have to check for names to make sure I'm remembering who it is, but I was like, this is a thing that I know. Like, the guy that made Hellboy worked on the art style for Atlantis, which is why it has such a distinct comic feel to it outside of the rest of the Disney properties.
But they complement the like otherworldly stuff. It's like, this is a piece of technology that's way too advanced for this time, which we get into the submarine, or it's like, hey, this is straight up magic. When we talk about the I always call them the fish bikes. The crystal
sporty
technology,
you know, like a tuna.
They stick the 3D stuff to that, because even in the climax, when we get our what would eventually become the superhero movie space laser trope, even that's mostly done in two dimensionally.
I think a lot of the blast effects, like a lot of particle and blast effects are still kind of done in that like swirl smoke two dimensional style that we see coming out of Mulan as well. It's a very like distinctive looking smoke and clearing. I think the laser blasts specifically from these, but the three dimensions are kept to either showcasing the grand scale of environments, like we sweep out and we get a whole shot of the city of Atlantis. We get a big sweeping, like, here is the docking bay where we see the submarine Ulysses as she's being prepared to go on her voyage.
Yeah,
and then the vehicles, like the spoilers, the big statues surrounding Atlantis, those, the vehicles, and then I think the Leviathan are really the things that stand out of like, that's three-dimensional, that has shape and depth. Mostly because, especially in the Leviathan, I think that's one of the best darn pieces of that, where it's that like, this is a terrifying creature because you're seeing it move in such a disjointed way that I don't know if the way that everything else is being like two-dimensionally animated, it would have read the same. So for it to feel otherworldly in that sense makes it like, it's a jarring kind of like, oh yeah, I don't like looking at this thing either. It scares me too. Get me out of here.
Yeah. And I think that's the coolest thing about the Disney passion projects, you know, Lilo and Stitch, Treasure Planet, Atlantis, Brother Bear, they are all artistically and visually super amazing. Critically,
I think Lilo and Stitch is the one exception to that.
Lilo
bunch,
and Stitch
but it
is
kind
of like the king.
But it was also one of those that had to push for like, we're doing watercolor backgrounds. Stop it. This is what our style is going to be.
I bring that up because as much as you and I absolutely adore this film, at the time, it wasn't received very well.
Cowards.
One of the biggest things is the cast, not that they weren't well done, but this movie's quick, right? It's an hour and a half.
Yes.
And it's got this wonderful, colorful cast outside of our titular characters, Milo and Kida. There's also Vinny, there's Dr. Sweet, there's Moliere, there's Jackie. There's so many characters who...
Hey, Jackie? You mean Audrey Ramirez?
Audrey, sorry. Jackie is the voice actor's real name. Sorry. Yes,
yeah.
Audrey. There's so many colorful characters. Yeah. And they stick with you, right? Especially Vinny. Vinny gets so many very fun one-liners.
Cookie, Mole. Like, it's such a great, like, rogues gallery. Like, mm-hmm. And that, like, they are scary. And you do find out that, like, yeah, pretty much everybody has some kind of a, like, a rap sheet or a, like, record of some kind.
We find out they're all basically mercenaries.
Yeah. So, but it is like soft rogues gallery where they're like, yeah, like colorful cast of characters in both senses. Cause it's that like, yeah, you have like
extremely multiracial, like, which not only for the time setting is
personality.
Yeah. But which not only for the time setting is unusual, for the real life setting is like even in 2001 to have this many races and cultures identified into one movie was super unusual, which for me as a kid. Made it really fun. Obviously, I associated with Sweet the most.
Joshua Sweet, medical officer. I love, like, everybody's introductions make them all, like, unique, too. It's not just, like, he's the black guy. He's, like, the Italian guy, whatever. Like, everybody's introductions solidify immediately, like, who they are. In this gallery, and that one's always one of my favorites of just the like, I'm paying attention to you and I'm asking doctor questions, but I'm also just like running through my list of things.
And them being multi-ethnic only accents that, right?
Yeah.
Like Vinny's main thing isn't that he's an Italian guy, is that he's a demolitionist who used to work as a florist.
Yeah. Right?
Moyer being a weird dirt guy, happening to have speaking French and having a French accent just makes him that much funnier.
What's Mole's story? Trust me on this. You don't want to know.
Audrey, don't tell him.
You shouldn't have told me. And I'm telling you, you don't want to know. It's also, if you can't tell, an insanely quotable script.
Oh my God. But where I bring this up because that's honestly one of the movie's weaknesses. We don't get to spend a lot of times with these characters.
Yes. Part of that is that this is unfortunately one of those, like, we had to contain this movie down to 90 minutes because, especially in the 2000s, that was the formula. Because who in their right mind is going to want to sit in a movie theater for over 2 hours?
Yeah.
Look how far we've fallen.
Well, like, and then, like, longer movies was isolated to, like, cinema, in quotations, right? Yes. Like, shit, like, Lord of the Rings hadn't come in quite yet and said, fuck you, the short version of this movie is 2 hours long.
Yeah.
Right.
Let alone superhero power 2 hours, my God. Not a power hour. But, like, it was a time for Disney, especially where they were like, yeah, we were trying to peak, like capitalize on this peak market. And like, especially for kids, 90 minutes is that interest. We got to make sure like we're keeping on that.
Yeah.
Money, reasons.
Like this movie definitely could have used like an extra 30 minutes.
Yes. Because even every time I've rewatched it, I definitely see where it feels like it's written well, despite the constraints. But you can tell that it is clipped for time in that way.
Yeah.
That. Part of the plan to counter the like, okay, yes, we understand it's short, but seeing that like, hey, there is still a solid idea here and there's potential for more, let's make a series.
Yeah.
And that didn't happen. And so its reputation got worse because the second movie, quote unquote, was three pilot episodes strung together and they're bad.
They're awful.
But like at the very least, you do get to spend a little more time with these characters that were like, ah, I want more of them. Ah, fuck. Not like this. God, no.
I always forget Atlantis 2 is a movie because I remember it as one of those Toon Disney. Oh, yeah. Atlantis got a show like Tarzan and Buzz Lightyear and Hercules and Goof Troop. It's like, no, it was just a really bad movie.
Yeah. It was supposed to be a series, but that didn't get greenlit any further, which sucks because you do see these really great, like, yeah, you see what this dynamic could have been. And like that the characters, even if voice actors changed and stuff like that, like these are still characters that really shine through and play well off of each other. But like, oh, the rest of this is rushed and cliche and not as captivating and like I wanted, you wish there could be a stronger monster of the week premise here if that's the route we're going down. But like, again, you can tell this was a concept that was rushed to completion that was then scrutinized and judged and went, no, we're not making more of those. Just make it into a movie.
Yeah, the other controversy this movie got was, obviously its main influence was 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea.
Yeah.
Much like the other Disney passion projects, Lilo and Stitch is based on just like UFO stories. The original pitch for it was that it happened in Kansas. I'm really glad they said, no, Hawaii is much cooler.
Yeah.
Treasure Planet is 1-to-1 Treasure Island.
What? Crazy. You mean the Muppet Treasure Island? The only true adaptation.
The only real version. The problem that Atlantis got was it actually got sued for plagiarism. There's a 1990s anime called Nadia, The Secret of Blue Water. We're doing this live. Oh. Kaylee, I want you to look up Nadia, The Secret of Blue Water.
Oh, this is going to be a Kimba the White Lion thing.
Yeah,
give that
shit a quick Google search.
Nadia, The Secret of Blue Water.
One Google search later.
I would raise the question, though, of this being a, but have you guys heard of Nausicaa Valley of the Wind? Because I would ask that question there. Yeah, but I do see the
it's the 1-to-1
cover art alone. Yeah, it's not a good look.
It's the same fucking characters. Nadia, Secret of Blue Water is an extremely similar story with extremely similar looking characters
from a concept of Hayao Miyazaki.
So they got sued for plagiarism.
I didn't know movie. About.
Yeah. Not to mention they also got in trouble. Speaking of Miyazaki films that this movie is way too similar to. They also got in trouble. People also brought up Castle in the Sky, one of the more popular ones. Yeah, that one I scrutinized a tiny bit harder. I see it.
I get, like, if you're there's a certain point you have to stop, like, not everything that is a fantastical vehicle is Howl's Moving Castle, is Castle in the Sky. Like, that is a trope that has been around. Were you going to sit here and tell me that Castlevania, that Dracula's Moving Castle is actually ripping off of that too?
Yes.
Like, pick your battles, please.
Yeah, I think it was more so we were already finding stuff that this is really similar. Because I think the other thing, Stargate, people also said this is Stargate.
That one I've definitely heard. And
that one I pushed viciously on. I'm like, no.
There are some pieces that I think shine out pretty, like, yeah, that's questionable as a reference. But it's also a little bit like, if you're not...
I can make shining blue portal and you can't be like, that's Stargate.
Yeah, right? Like there's a level of like, Atlantis sits in a very strange pocket of intersection because on the one hand, it is sci-fi.
Yeah.
It is also action adventure.
Yeah.
And it is like not just the like fantasy part of sci-fi, but it is fantastical. Like it is intersecting in three, I think, different enough genres. Like, yes, sci-fi crosses a lot of the borders between the other two. I get it. I know. But since we aren't fully steampunk here, we're going to call it sci-fi and move on. That it is hard to sit in a pocket of those things and not, like, you know, it's not like an argument that's just like, oh, you can just steal because you're a sci-fi movie, because you're an action adventure movie. Like, that's not what I'm saying. But it's, you know, a little difficult to sit in a genre and not use ideas that also exist in the genre in order to be classified as such.
There's so many tropes that pull from real world, like the entire action adventure genre.
Yeah.
Pull straight from westward expansion of Europe. Right.
Yeah.
Like it's like I go across the sea to go across something I don't really understand to somewhere I've never been There's probably people there. They're probably going to be brown. And oh, snap, we're trying to tell a compelling story. I fall in love with one of the natives, but we can't be together because our worlds are so different. It's like you can't. Yeah. That's pools mostly for real life, but also fantasize. We'll take out some of the scarier parts of imperialism and colonialization, obviously, hopefully, kind of. Or we'll make those the bad guys. But
yeah, let's do that. That's a good plan. Yep.
Yeah. But to say that everything that follows that formula is just a copy of the first thing that we say was super, super popular. I outside of Nadia and the Secret of Blue Water, like I would have took that to court too.
When did those did those claims arise like as it was coming out, or did those claims like happen afterward?
I think it came, I was like, as it was coming out, because Nadia and Secret of Blue Water came out in 1990. So no, 10 like
you're almost
years
a decade
before.
Apart between yeah. the two. Yeah.
Let me not lie.
One more Google search later.
Okay, correction. They did not actually get sued. There were people who called to
sue.
Oh,
sure.
Yeah, yeah.
Sure. But that's also, I'm questioning that in the same line of like again, where people get ideas from could be a variety of places, and that's sometimes it is just like, it's not that ideas exist in a vacuum, but yeah, sometimes you can have almost the same idea halfway across the world many years later than the person who made it on the other side of the world.
I think these motherfuckers wrote Pocahontas like 6 years before they started writing this thing, and they're like, hey, let's just do that again.
Oh my god, no, Pocahontas, like I could go on a rant about the production of that movie. Lion King was the banishment project in Disney Studios.
How so?
They were so convinced that Pocahontas was going to be this like emotionally elevated, like beautiful piece of film that was not only going to cater to like young and old audiences, but was going to like address questions and identity, like all that jazz, like big epic storytelling based on history, based on real life, that the silly talking animals musical was the banishment project.
Yeah.
For the people that they went,
the silly talking animals musical that we hired Sir Elton John.
And that was Jeffrey Katzenberg being kind of pseudo banished to that film as well, and going,
that's
all right,
awesome.
Hit me. And so Lion King like fucking roared to success. Pocahontas was met with this like, what the hell was this?
Yeah.
In what way is this close any kind of historical accuracy, like not even being word for word accurate, just like in the ballpark, my guy.
The guy Pocahontas actually married in real life was your main villain. And Pocahontas was not okay.
12.
We understand she was 12. We also understand she was not okay with getting taken to England. I'm looking at you, Pocahontas 2.
Oh my god.
Bullshit
yeah, no,
ass
like,
movie.
Yeah. Just a lot of things they were like, oh, we're so convinced of this, that backfired.
Yeah.
That I think to some extent, I would hope, you know, I don't know for how long, because this was also peak Michael Eisner era Disney. So yeah. I don't like they animation studio was getting pitched things kind of on a whim, like kind of through research, but kind of on a whim of like, yeah, let's appeal to the kids. We got to be cool. We gotta like get hip with the youth in a very cringy way. Not directly quote, but basically to quote Michael Eisner through his tenure as CEO of the company. That, yeah, no, like it's, there were worthwhile things to draw from as inspiration that, like, in looking towards like, well, what are other things we can try to do that aren't fairy tale musicals?
Yeah.
You know, there are a lot of iconic tropes that emerge in sci-fi and fantasy. And you know what? That's what defines the genre. Otherwise, what do you have?
It's just so funny to me that this era of Disney is like, fuck, we can't do fairy tales anymore. What do we do? Brothers Grimm, we've used it all. I don't know, y'all motherfuckers ever read a novel? Let's do that. I got like three
Who's
of these.
Who's this
on my
Jules kid. Verne fellow?
Let's just break out one of those. I got a bookshelf in here somewhere.
Yeah, you know.
Pulls out 20,000 Leagues Under
quickly,
the Sea. Yeah, we could do this.
Boot up the old 2000s gateway computer and search on the Google what is non-copyrighted free for use.
Throw in the floppy disk, see what I can't figure out, man.
But no, like I remember the Stargate one being a thing going around, and I think even in like talks later on, like the creators kind of memed on it a little bit of like, yeah, maybe there were some pieces that were in the back of our minds, but not like a direct like, oh, we're just mm-hmm. I'd like just to steal. Like never quite like that. I think things that they wanted to homage in some ways, and like that's not like an offense to make in either live action or animation. Like nodding to things that you've been inspired by is kind of a like worthwhile thing to include if you want to own up to it, like in that, like, yeah, this was the reference.
Yeah,
good job.
And I think that's nice.
Moving on.
For people who haven't seen this movie, you know, we Kaylee and I said up top, we're super go watch it, it's fun.
Yes.
But there's a lot familiar in it, right? Is it a little too quick? Yes.
Yes.
Is stuff kind of if you're one of the like the if you tell me you've ever seen Nadia and the Secret of Blue Water, you're either Japanese or a liar. I don't believe you.
I didn't know that
don't
existed.
Worry about
I thought this was like a spin-off of Nausicaa of the Valley of the Wind.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But I mean, if it's Miyazaki, I'm like, well, that explains the fucking similar ass title.
Right. Give it a look. I wonder because you're a little more plugged into this stuff than I am. How has the longevity of this film been?
Rabid.
Really?
In certain circles is the unfortunate answer, though, because this era kind of gets like the short end of the stick a lot. Like people just shit on the early 2000s Disney before we went back into our stride with Tangled and like more of a reunification with Pixar kind of era. That the 2000s is kind of just written off as this like, there's nothing here. It's garbage up until we get to this point.
Yeah.
Which I find flawed in some ways of like, yeah, not all of it is the same quality as the Disney Renaissance.
Yeah.
But also, we were trying things. And I think a lot of it worked more than you're willing to give it credit for. It just maybe felt a little weird to you at the time. I don't know, but like
also,
I would
also
call...
y'all motherfuckers remember Brave? Brave sucked.
Hey.
Yeah, get out of here. Brave is bad.
No, I always want to remember Brave in rose-colored glasses, but that's also because so much happened in that production that I wish could have been undone, and it had such a great concept at first that got fucked over from corporate meddling. This is also like later 2000s, not early, but later 2000s into the 2010s is when we really start to see the corporatification of like, oh, clearly somebody asked for this to change.
Yeah.
And now it's worse.
Yeah.
But
Atlantis.
Same with Hunchback and the Gargoyles. But I think Atlantis was that like we're constantly having to check ourselves to make sure that we're family friendly still. But like we want to depart from the like softer things. And also, if we can tell a war story like Mulan, then this should arguably be on the table. Because the other thing that is very notable about Atlantis.
Yeah.
Is the body count.
I've never thought about that.
Have you never thought about the fact we blow up a submarine and there
a lot
are
of
only
people
three
die.
Ships that make it out?
I've never... Because they're all drones. They're all stormtroopers.
Sure.
Oh, right.
Sure.
Only what? They set off with the fleet. Only
they set,
three
they set
of
off
them.
With a fleet of
and only
little
three
sub-pods.
Of them make it.
Yes. you have the big submarine that we lose God knows how many of the crew that are just trapped and can't evacuate when that goes down. We have the fleet of sub pods. I think it's like 10 of them that explode out of the sides. And I think only get two that we see, at least. Like, we see two vehicles. Like, we are in the POV of one as we come into the cave.
Yeah.
And we see one in front that's like, we have two or three, basically, of that entire fleet make it and finish the journey.
In Disney parallels, it's like Black Panther. Where that the act when they're in, I think, South Korea or whatever, and T'Challa is like throwing dudes under cars and whatnot.
Yeah.
And people are like, oh God, he's killing them dudes.
Yeah.
Ah, man.
No, it's that levels of like Mulan has massacred hundreds of men under a snowbank.
Yeah, and, like, I guess she did.
Yeah, yeah. There's, I don't remember who made this video essay. I think this was Shea Frillis. I think, this was a film theory episode of like highest body count in a Disney animated feature. And Atlantis cracks into the top five, I believe.
Yeah.
I don't remember what number one is, but it is that like, oh yeah.
Yeah. a lot of people
There's a
die.
Lot of loss of life here. We have a memorial. Yeah. Just don't See, dwell I, on I was, it for too
I was
long.
Thinking... Atlantis tends to skirt the line of what acceptable kids movies jokes were.
Sure.
It like rides right on top of that. Obviously now we're just like, you can say shit.
You need to fill these up with what?
obviously now we can say like shit two or three times before we get an R rating, right? But that again, at the time, it's been 20 years. Shit's mad different. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna need you to fill these up. Everything with mole.
Everything with mole.
Vinny constantly talking about how he's gonna blow people up. You know what I mean? It's like, are we allowed to? We are allowed to say, Shrek came out this year. Yeah, we're allowed to say whatever we want. You know,
that is also the other. Was Shrek a spring release though? I thought
Shrek,
that was end of summer.
Yeah, that was also part of the reason why. Kind of changing direction.
Yeah, no, you're
part of the
competing
reason, yeah,
with that.
They were competing with Shrek and the first Tomb Raider movie when this came out, which is like, again, hard to believe that, the Lara Croft Tomb Raider, or not Lara Croft, Christina Aguilera? No, who the fuck am I thinking of? Maleficent. What's that lady's name?
Words!
Man,
I did this cosplay!
This proves how cool we are.
Yeah. No.
Angelina Jolie.
Angelina. No, but there's an A.
Yeah. Angelina Jolie's Tomb Raider and Shrek also came out at the same time, which is part of the reason why its box office. Well, it still came out in the black. But its box office was not great.
I think to your point, like of the original question, at least of like, is there still a rabid, like what happened afterwards? Yeah, because either you saw it when it came out and were like hook, line and sinker, I'm in, or people came back around to it after kind of having to weed through the like, oh, don't bother. This isn't great. And realize like, oh, actually, this is really damn good.
Yeah.
That's what I was thinking of. Shea Frillis, another YouTube commentator on animation in the industry that I enjoy their video essays and stuff.
Yeah.
That was one of the movies. He's like, I never really watched any of these. I heard they were all bad. Atlantis is now one of my favorite Disney movies because I finally watched it and went, oh my God. Like, yeah, it's rushed, but like it's not rushed, but like it's pressed for time. It moves quickly, perhaps more than you'd like. But it is like, this is an incredible action adventure that also does turn against trope and expectations in some very nice ways.
Yeah.
Like, I feel like we haven't said like much about the movie itself, but I think one of my favorite pieces of that is that like Kida is still such a badass. Like,
yeah.
And not even in like a fake feminism bullshit. Like,
she's just
straight
cool.
up badass warrior princess. It's like, yeah, the queen, my queen. Yes, madam.
This was definitely one of the Disney VHS tapes that was on rotation.
Yeah.
In my house. There was more than just Disney, but it was like this, Hercules and Aladdin's 1 and 3 were just like constantly.
We don't need Return of Jafar. We don't need Return of Jafar.
We don't talk about Return of Jafar. King of Thieves, though? Mm-hmm. King of Thieves, though?
They're fine. They're getting married at the wedding.
An interesting pop culture reference I've always associated with this movie. It seems like that rabid fan base is always asking for a live action remake of this one.
Yes.
Because it would work. It would work fairly easily. Definitely in like the rock style.
The moment Tom Holland and Zendaya, like, we're out in the scene as like Spider-Man and MJ. It was that like that.
Well, that is
our Milo and Keita.
Well, here's the thing. Here's the thing. Because you just hit a nail on the head. This movie is 1-to-1 tied at the hip with Spider-Man.
Yeah.
Because at one point, every Spider-Man, somebody on the internet has gotten a lot of traction saying that guy should be Milo. It happened with Garfield. It happened with every single one of them.
It also happened with Cole Sprouse. So
exactly. Right? And now it's like, so
either he's lined up to play Spider-Man.
Cole Sprouse for next Spider-Man confirmed. make it Miles. Disney cowers.
Ooh.
Miles or Gwen. I wouldn't mind a Gwen movie. I guess because it's brown hair guy who's acted as a nerdy parallel, make him my character, please revive this. And the B rank Disney movies much more fall in line in what would be a traditionally live action action adventure movie.
The thing that the 2000s, like the B movies were interested in, were pushing for things that hadn't really been seen in animation, like in a broad scope, in a large scale commercial movie kind of style. What they were interested in exploring exactly was more arguably often than not like, well, we'll just make a movie. We'll make the movie Journey to the Center of the Earth. We'll make the movie of Treasure Island. We'll make it again with Muppets, and that one is the superior one. But it's all still live action, and you're bound by the constraints of what you can do in live action, and that means sometimes they're going to look cheesy. We didn't figure out until later, when we started turning every movie studio into an actual just like box with green screens, how to make something look and feel more like larger than life.
Yeah.
But even then, that doesn't always work. So animation really wanted to come fill the gap in and go, but look at what could be possible and fit in a world that makes sense and isn't like overwhelming, but is just large enough to feel like you can get lost in and want to explore. It doesn't just feel like a standard stock. Here's a jungle. Here's a cave.
And I feel like the only studios that were really experimenting with that were like 20th Century, maybe WB sometimes. Films like Iron Giant and Titan A.E.
Yeah.
You know? And obviously they weren't as big as the Disney Renaissance movies that were coming out at the same time. But it worked. Right?
Unfortunately, you had animation kind of primed, like animation and video games respectively, primed in this place of like, we can start pushing the boundaries of what's possible based on like what we're able to do. Style-wise and blending components-wise, we can push the look and the feel of things versus Pixar and a lot of other studios that were just convinced that 3D animation was the way.
Yeah.
They were attempting to put a square peg in a round hole that you either had some people like Pixar kind of doing it right, where they went, well, hey, it looks really cheesy and plasticky, so what, like, they're toys.
Yeah,
that's how we make this work. We make them toys, we make them bugs, we play with texture a little bit more, and we make them big fluffy monsters, but like it's still a little weird and like uncomfy to look at, but they're monsters, it's fine.
DreamWorks,
like,
same thing. It's like, yeah, now they're super stylized, their heads are really big, their bodies
but
are
you're still learning to get a grasp on the new medium and show it off in a way that actually makes sense versus animation, where it's like, yeah, we could pick the best of both worlds right now because it's easy enough for us to adapt something to fit around the way something else already looks.
Yeah.
And with that, we can push for something newer and different and that maybe hasn't been quite explored in this way before. But unfortunately, people don't like that. People just like what they know they like.
Give me
ain't
same
that
thing.
The same old, same old.
Give me same thing, but different, please.
Exactly. In the time since Atlantis came out, there was a video game that came out for various platforms. I had like the PC version of it. There were
an Atlantis game.
Yeah, yeah. There was CD-ROM, like pack of games. There was something else, I believe, that came out for Game Boy.
I didn't play these.
I don't remember if it ever made it to a PlayStation system or not in any form of like three-dimensional game. But again, it was trying to figure out, like, the idea was like young boys will probably like this movie. So how do we reach them? Video games. So we made a game of it. We advertised it on Disney Channel with a lot of behind the scenes, cool action sort of sounding vibes and whatnot. But it just didn't pick up immediately the way, like, again, that they would hope, but it also, again, didn't help that you're competing with Shrek for attention that summer. But in the fallout, people have come around to the movie, people have always been for the movie, and you have, you know, in the nonsense of the world that accrued online during the pandemic, you had a number of new groups forming, some of which were, hey, we are all pretending to be ants in an anthill. And other sort of fandom specific shitposting groups. One of the first ones that I got like pinged for that was like, oh, I don't even know anybody here, but like this is on my radar now, was Atlantis, the Lost Empire posting. And now I'm friends with the creatives of the show, the movie. Like they're my Facebook friends. It's like, what the fuck? Hello? It was a strange time. But I can say I'm Facebook friends with Gary Trousdale and Tab Murphy.
I'm looking up this Atlantis game.
One final Google search. Okay, I think this bit has run its course.
Atlantis Lost Empire Trial by Fire. Why is it Doom? Why is Milo shooting people with goo and getting shot at in first person?
We just ported Doom, okay?
Why is it Doom? Why not? Why not like a side scroller? Why not like Prince of Persia? Why not?
I don't know.
Why Doom?
I don't know. I couldn't tell you, unfortunately. I don't think the one that I had like as a computer game had that. Like, I remember like puzzle games. Like it was a multi-pack of stuff. But yeah,
1940s nerdy historian Milo with an AK ready to go ripping and tearing.
But yeah, no, there's a lot that has persisted with this movie. There is a continuously strong thriving base that exactly like wants a live action adaptation, because I still agree, like, you revise the script a little bit better.
Yeah,
as much as we were trying to imitate real life and make it fantastical, fine. If we don't want to do that, then you can at least take something that would make a very damn good live action movie, because it is arguably within the bounds of what live action does in that, like, yeah, we make it a little fantastical, but it's still a piece of it is pretty darn grounded.
At this point, you could brand it like a new IP, make a little 9-10 episode miniseries, hour long episodes, throw it up on Disney Plus, it'll do gangbusters, man.
Yeah,
like,
are you kidding me?
It really would.
Like, I would expect the same, if not more, response to Percy Jackson.
I forgot that came out.
Yeah, it did, and it's okay. It's pretty good. I want to see them like do a little better with season two, but like,
yeah,
better than I thought it was gonna be. Just also still feels a little cheap, and I wonder where some of that money in the production went to. Gee,
Lin-Manuel Miranda started positivity
and
posting.
We had to spend so much to get this man in as Hermes.
He started positivity posting on Twitter, and folks started ripping cash from him. It's like, make him stop.
Please
right now.
Get him off of this set as fast as you can. But no, like it is one of those that I think Atlantis sits in the pocket of a lot of intersections of like things that people like enjoyed in previous properties, whether it's anime or not, whether it's Stargate. Honestly, even something like Firefly, like I could see this being like Disney's version of Firefly if they really wanted to find a way to like, you know, again, intersection of how do we capture new audiences, recapture old ones that'll spend their money on us again, but give people something different when so much out there feels just like more Star Warsification of things where it's big, grand storytelling that's like, but I don't care enough about the original story, so I don't care about this corner of it. Like, just give me a problem of the week more than anything. Like, I don't care about long arcs. Y'all don't seem to have anything that doesn't care about long overarching story, and yet here is something that can so easily fill the gap of like, we take it down an archaeology exploration route. We take it down a like the what happens after of the city and the characters. We do the whole thing again, but exactly as a miniseries instead, and give the journey room to breathe that way. But it just feels like a waste to let that sit on the shelf.
Yeah.
After just the like, again, not only just like the beautiful artwork, but it is truly, I think, that voice cast that like gives that movie so much more like staying power of just like, there's such wonderful performances in this that I could absolutely see this working in live action if you got the right people for it. But you have like, you have Michael J. Fox and Cree Summer leading this film along with just like an incredible, well, like talented seasoned cast of voice actors and actors that it's just this like, I can't not imagine this being done in real life, so why haven't you?
Go watch this movie.
Do it.
It's fucking good. That's been this episode of the Liberal Artist Podcast. Thank you so much for joining us. Follow us on our socials at Lib Artist Pod on Instagram. We have a YouTube channel where we repost our episodes. Go do all that bullshit YouTube asks that you do for the algorithm.
Give in to the content, father.
Thank you so much for joining us. Join us next time when Kaylee and I make a live action adaptation of whatever book I find in my bookshelf. Hold on. The Southern Book Club's Guide to Slaying Vampires.
Nice.
Peace.
The Liberal Artist Podcast premieres every other Thursday on your favorite podcasting platform. The show is hosted by Bodhi Opapula, Kaylee Horowitz, and Andy Gibson. You can find the show at Liberal Artists Pod on Instagram and Twitter. Thanks to White Hot for performing the theme song Reflect, which can be found on freebeats.io. Now, I'm off to go exploring, and maybe, maybe, just maybe, I'll find a sheep that I can call my own. Good day.
What's on my shelf? My shelf pile. First one on the pile. Is a parody is a Board of the Rings. Excellent.
All right, I'm gonna stop.